Bam! Mr. Taru, in this pre-calculus video, we're going to be doing two examples, or maybe algebra 2 honors, of solving polynomial inequalities using a graphical approach. This is an addition to a lesson I've done a number of years ago, solving these polynomial inequalities using an analytical approach. I'll have a link to that older lesson in the description if you would like to see a second technique. We're going to be solving this polynomial inequality and graphing the solution set on a number line. Our first example, we have x cubed plus 2x squared minus 9x minus 18 is less than or equal to 0. And the start of this process is going to look like our other technique that's in the other video, which is we're going to solve this for 0. Even if it wasn't part of the inequality, we would either be finding the critical values we're going to use along the number line to test the intervals, set up the intervals we will test, or in this case, using a graphical approach, we want to find those x-intercepts. So anytime you have a polynomial with four terms, or if the degree is higher than 2, a higher order polynomial, these can be quite a bit of work to solve. Unless, of course, it's you can solve it through factoring, and that's what we're going to do here. Given those four terms, quite often you're going to be factoring by grouping. So what common factor can we take out of these first two terms? Well, they both have a factor of x. Their coefficients don't have anything in common in terms of factors, like 1 and 2, but we do have a common factor of x, and we're going to take out that lowest power. So we're going to factor out that lowest power. So we're going to factor out that x squared. When factoring out a monomial, of course, we do that through division. It's the inverse math operation of multiplication, which is what we do when we distribute through parentheses. X cubed divided by x squared. Well, if you have 3 and you took out 2, that just leaves you with 1. And we have 2x squared and divided by x squared. Of course, the x squared is going to divide out to be 1, leaving you with 2 times 1, which is equal to 2. Now, when you're factoring by grouping, that factoring by grouping does not work, of course, unless you can get that group, that expression that's in the parentheses, to show up again. And if you can't get the x plus 2 in this case to show up again, then this polynomial is not factorable by grouping. And by the way, polynomials are functions that have one independent variable and all of the exponents are positive integers. If you have an exponent that's negative or a fractional exponent, then that's not a polynomial. Now we can factor out between us common factors of 9 and 18. Of course, we have a common factors of 2 and 9. You want to take out the biggest usually. And we have these terms of x and 2, which are positive, our 9x and 18 are negative. So yeah, we're going to factor out a negative 9, and negative 9x divided by negative 9 is positive 1x, and negative 18 divided by negative 9, again, is positive 2. Looking to make this sort of basically less than or equal to 0. You noticed that we had that common factor of x squared when we factored it out. We only had it right at once. We had a common factor of negative 9 when we factored it out. We only had it right at once. And here we have a common factor of x plus 2. And we went from 1, 2, 3, 4 terms separated by addition and subtraction to just 2 terms separated by this 1 minus sign. You have some pluses in here, but the parentheses are locking all that together like a vice grip. So it is just 2 terms separated by that minus sign. So we're going to factor out that common factor of x plus 2. And again, we're dividing that out. So x squared times x plus 2 divided by x plus 2 will just leave you with the x squared. And negative 9 times x plus 2 divided by x plus 2 is going to leave you with that factor of minus 9. Now, we have a difference of squares. That's a very common factoring pattern, which I'm sure by now you have down pat. And the factoring of x squared minus 9 is going to become x plus 3 times x minus 3. Just using some vocab out there, this is a pair, this is a conjugate pair where the terms are the same, but just the middle sign is different. They're opposites. The middle sign's opposite. Now again, remembering, we're trying to think of a sketch that is going to help us solve this polynomial inequality. We're trying to quickly sketch y is equal to x cubed plus 2x squared minus 9x minus 18. And this sketch can even be in your mind. just a quicker way of helping you solve this polynomial inequality. Now, how do you get all of this to equal zero? Well, any one of these terms could potentially be zero, and this whole expression would be zero. So either x plus 2 is going to be zero, or could be zero, x plus 3, or x minus 3. And of course, the solution to all of these one-step equations is x is negative 2, x is negative 3, or x being equal to 3. Any one of these x values is going to turn this entire factored expression to be equal to 0, which makes them all x-intercepts of this graph. Okay. Now this graph is not the solution. This isn't the graphing of the solution on the number line. This is the mental or very quick sketch you're doing on your paper to help you solve this problem. So we have those as x-intercepts of negative 3, negative 2, and positive 3. Great. Well, now what else do we know from graphing polynomials that's going to give us a solution to this inequality without a whole lot of additional work? Getting my fancy picture in picture? The multiplicities of these solutions, these three solutions came from these three factors. And each of these three factors only showed up once, which means their multiplicity is odd. So these x-intercepts of negative 3, negative 2, and 3, the graph is going through those x-intercepts, and because our leading coefficient is positive with an odd degree, that combination is going to give us end behavior of down to the left and up to the right. So just with that little bit of knowledge, we can visualize this graph. We have those x-intercepts of negative 3, negative 2, and positive 3. We know the graph has an end behavior of down to the left and up to the right, and the graph is passing through these x-intercepts. Now, I guess it doesn't take too long. If x is equal to 0, then my y-intercept is negative 18, which isn't even on my chalkboard here, but the graph is coming down. It's going to come down somewhere down there at negative 18 and come up through x equals 3. Now, in terms of graphs, this expression, the whole x cubed plus 2x squared minus 9x minus 18, is giving our values of y if we were graphing. So where along this graph are my y values less than or equal to 0? Well, that would include this portion of the graph and this portion. Oh, I don't know if it's going to show up very well against the yellow. Hopefully the red. Sometimes red doesn't show up too much in the camera. But those two intervals are where the y values are either equal to 0 or less than. So with interval notation, our solution is between negative infinity, coming in here from the left, and up until we get to negative 3, or from negative 2 to positive 3. Then, of course, that on a number line, hold on a second. I can actually include the values of negative 3, negative 2, and positive 3 because we have an equal sign as part of our inequality. So that means I need to come back through here in my interval notation and not use round parentheses, which means sort of just less than or greater than, but include the inequality, which says, no, I'm actually including these numbers in my solution. It's not just going up to negative 3 or just between negative 2 and negative positive 3. We're not including those numbers. Now, the directions say to graph this on a number line, so now we can just come through here and say there's 0, 1, 2, 3, negative 1, negative 2, negative 3, negative 4. And our shading is coming in from negative infinity up until negative 3, and then going between negative 2 solid dots because we're including those numbers, again, because of that equal sign going on there. And that's our graph on the number line. That's the end of my first solution or example. We got one more coming up right now. Alrighty, for our last example, very, very similar to the previous one. I'm just bringing this up because we don't have an equal sign as part of our inequality. And I just want to remind you about that multiplicity again. And what's the difference between an even multiplicity and an odd? So we have x squared minus 10x plus 25 is greater than 0. We want to solve this polynomial just like before. Let's get it set equal to 0. And we're going to do that by factoring it. We have a leading coefficient, which is just simply 1, and thus we're only looking for, we don't have to really consider leading coefficient very much in our thought process of how to factor this. Just look for factors of 25 that add to be negative 10. So we don't want 5 and positive 5, we want 2 negative 5s. X times x is x squared, we have x times negative 5, and another negative 5x gives us negative 10x when you add them, and of course negative 5 times negative 5 is positive 25. Now, I wrote each of those factors only once, but they are the same factor. So I could write this as x minus 5 squared. And again, though this is, we're looking for an inequality where it's just greater than 0, if we're thinking about graphing y is equal to x squared minus 10x plus 25 and using that graph to help us finish this solution of this polynomial inequality, then we need the x-intercept. So where is x minus 5 equal to 0? Of course, that's going to be x equals 5. We have here this x-intercept, the 0, is coming from a factor which shows up twice. So now, if you have an even multiplicity, that means you're just touching at this x-intercept. And because you have, again, a positive leading coefficient with a now degree which is even instead of odd, then the end behaviors, remember when we were graphing polynomial functions, the end behavior was either up to the left and up to the right, or if the leading coefficient was negative, of course, it was down and down. So knowing the end behavior from that positive leading coefficient or that leading coefficient test, and understanding that multiplicity here is even so the graph just touches, this is what the graph, and it's just a sketch. I'm not going to make sure every single point of my sketch is really kind of like in the proper place, but I know I have a parabola where every single y value is, you know, above the x-axis except exactly at 5 where the y value is 0 because it's an x-intercept. So our solution to this polynomial inequality is that we have solutions from negative infinity to 5. Now I'm going to use a round parentheses, right? Because there's no equal sign in our inequality. It's just greater than. Or we can pick up on the other side of 5, so like 4.99999 and 5.00001, and then we're going to go from 5 to infinity and beyond. That on the number line is going to look like this. And I forgot to mention this in the other example. We're going to put an open dot on 5 because we're not, 0 is not part of the solution, but we are going to show that the shading is basically everywhere on the number line except for that open dot that we have at 5. Now the difference between either sketching very, very quickly a sketch of the polynomial or just even thinking about it in your head, and the other technique that we used for solving polynomial inequalities was that if we were just doing this purely analytically, this 5 would be sort of like a critical number along the x along the number line, and then you test just a single number in each that are in between each of those critical values on the number line. You take each of these numbers along the number line, you know, one from each interval, and you plug them into these factored expressions to see if those answers are positive or negative, and thus do they satisfy, you know, the inequality which you're trying to solve. But if you know how to graph your polynomial functions and you know how that multiplicity works, that multiplicity here works with the x-intercepts and your end behavior, you can get a picture of that polynomial in your mind and use that, or just sketch it quickly for your teacher so you get, you know, some credit for showing your work, and allow you to speed up that process of solving these polynomials and polynomial inequalities, allowing you more time to work on the other problems that are on your test and in your homework. So I am Mr. True. Go to your homework.